be just a conversation between Melissa and I. We want everybody to think about when you are ready for financial advice, best thing to do is to talk to your parents, your guardians, do some online research, go to a bank when you're ready to talk to someone. We are bankers ourselves, but today we're not here to just talk about banking. We also care about helping you be money smart. So keeping that in mind, a little bit more on myself. I am a commercial account manager, and I focus on agriculture. And Melissa, what do you do?
So Carson and I work together, and I'm also in the agriculture sector for RBC. I work on the account side, and Carson does the credit side. As Carson mentioned, our presentation today will be about savings, and this presentation is geared toward youth, so high school to university. But if that's not your age group, I 100% believe that you will also find something of value in today's presentation, because as we mentioned, it's just general savings advice, not specific to any products or services that RBC may offer or other banks. So we're going to hop into it. This link here is RBC Future Launch at Home, and you can Google that or even copy that link down now. This is a wonderful resource that's available for you to check out from home that has a whole bunch of YouTube videos, articles, seminars, information on all things Future Launch. So RBC Future Launch is RBC's commitment to youth. It's a $500 million commitment over the next 10 years. And this website encompasses a lot of the resources that are available through Future Launch. So, for example, items on networking, professional development. You'll find actual resources for mental health well-being, as we know that's so important, and information on how to improve your work experience as well. And we're going to go on to our – yeah, go ahead.
As I had mentioned kind of on the first slide, just to set some guidelines, we're not here to give advice necessarily right now about some financial products with RBC, and we do want you to do your own research when it comes to financial advice. Talk to your parents, talk to your guardians, and do your own research when it's time to ask some of these questions. But with that, I think all of us, who doesn't love money, right?
It's a good topic to talk about.
Exactly. And it's something that I don't know very many people that aren't looking for more money. But the reality is that most of us aren't going to win the lottery, and we need to be smart with our money. So,
Carson, if you did win the lottery, what would you spend it on? What would be the first thing? Not to go detailed full budget, but what's the first thing you would get?
Personally, I would probably buy a farm.
Okay, that is a good answer. I was, hoping for like a speedboat or maybe like a tropical vacation, But a farm is very responsible and makes a lot of sense. I support it. the reality is most of us aren't going to win the lottery, and that's why savings is so important. Especially Carson and I talk about this personally because we're colleagues. The life stage that we're in now, we're both kind of trying to figure out how to be grown up, buy houses, put money aside for retirement, all that stuff. And it's definitely really difficult. So talking about savings, while it's not always the most exciting, does help prepare you better for that life stage.
So do you think that could potentially go wrong if we did win the lottery and we weren't prepared for it?
Yes, obviously, definitely could. I'm a horrible saver, and I'm self-proclaimed, and I'm a banker, you guys, so don't feel bad if savings doesn't come naturally to you. The next little bit we're going to actually talk about is an example of that. So there's a story of a woman from Hamilton. Her name's Sharon Tirabassi. In 2004, she won $10.5 million, which is a crazy amount of money. And unfortunately, Sharon didn't do so good with her money. She decided that she was going to buy fancy vacations, buy houses for all her friends, by fancy designer clothes. And actually, over the course of 9 years, Sharon spent all the money that she won. Didn't save any of it, just spent it all away. And now Sharon is back to living a regular, non-luxury life. This isn't totally sad, though, because Sharon does proclaim, and there's lots of articles, you can even Google her. She says that she's happier now. She feels more balanced. She understands the value of money, and she wouldn't want to win the lottery again. But there were some super important lessons in terms of how to manage your money. Obviously, also, managing your money can go super well.
When you do manage your money, it can have really, really good rewards. So another example, a little bit on the other side of the spectrum, is Sean Cooper, who you could also Google. He's in the news because he used his financial savviness and his dedication to reach a goal of paying off his $255,000 mortgage as soon as he could. That ended up taking him only 3 years and 2 months, which for a lot of people, it can take 20 or more years to get their mortgage paid off. So Sean, he bought his house at 27, and by 30, he had it paid off. He actually wrote a book about it. So if you look up Burn Your Mortgage by Sean Cooper, you can find some more information on that. But how did Sean actually manage to pull that off? He worked three jobs. He lived frugally in his basement, renting out the top level. He rode his bike everywhere instead of spending money on fuel and car insurance. And he home prepared all of his meals. And he made a lot of sacrifices, like not going out with his friends all the time, social sacrifices. It definitely wasn't that easy for Sean to do that. And not everybody needs to do what Sean did, but it required a lot of focus, planning, discipline, and hard work to be able to be mortgage-free by age 30. Both the examples that we just talked about, though quite opposite ends of the spectrum, they really show no matter what situation you're in, it can be really important to manage your money.
Absolutely. So that's kind of the topic of today's whole presentation, is that it all adds up, or every little penny counts, or everything you do towards saving is important. And something that we're going to also address today is that savings is not easy, especially probably a lot of you on this call, if you are in the agriculture field, may already be working, may already be involved in your family farms. And if you're not agriculture related, you may also already have part-time, full-time jobs that you're balancing with your lives. And you know that savings isn't easy and life is expensive. And so it's important to put strategies in place in order to help you. I know that savings is hard for me, especially like I mentioned before. Life is fun. You want to buy lots of food and snacks and adventures with friends. What's your guilty pleasure spend, Carson?
The hardest thing for me when it comes to saving is if a friend or a colleague wants to go out and grab lunch. That's
right.
Probably the most
huge
one that really stops me from being able to save money. What about you?
Yeah, Uber Eats for sure, 100%. Especially now that we're like working from home for the pandemic, which some of you may be learning from home. Or working from home, depending on who's on the call here, it can be tricky, and it's so convenient to just press a button and you have something delivered to your door. So that's my guilty pleasure that adds up, that it all adds up really quickly. Well, let's look at that a little bit. Carson, do you want to talk about this exercise?
Sure. So if we think about just, like Melissa just said, it adds up really quick, something like going for lunch or even just a coffee. So let's say a $2 coffee. If we throw that
important
up in the chart as
that's a cheap coffee, what you think in your head.
Maybe if that's even more expensive. So this $2 a day, so if we say cost $2, frequency daily, let's say just during the week.
5 times per week.
So $10 a week, and then 52 weeks in a year. So just that $2 coffee ends up as $520 in 1 year. So imagine that was
huge.
Fancier coffee, and it was $4, euro for $1,040 right there. So for our $2 coffee, our yearly total added up to $520. What about something you do only weekly? Maybe you limit yourself to going out to lunch once a week.
Lunch?
I can easily see somebody spending on a nicer dinner or lunch $50. It was a fancy lunch.
Huge.
But how'd you need that every week? 52 weeks. That's $2,600 in 1 year.
Oops.
What could you do with $2,600? You might be able to buy a laptop, take a nice trip. But we're not here to make anybody feel bad about their spending. We just want to kind of put it into perspective. We're going to skip over that third example.
And, just move on. So something that we like to talk about is mantras or little phrases that you say to yourself to kind of keep positive momentum going. So the mantra for our presentation today is save today, choose tomorrow. An example of that would be putting that money, that coffee money away, would give you a little bit of extra space to purchase something nice at the end of the year or have extra money for emergency purposes like car repairs or something like that.
Or maybe something even more fun. What
exactly?
What are you saving for, Melissa?
I'm actually right now, well, pre-pandemic, I was saving for a trip to France for my friend's wedding. So she's postponed it to 2022. So right now I have a new chance to save for that trip. So I'm trying to strategize what that looks like. What about you? What are you saving for right now?
I'm getting pretty close to needing a new car, so that's definitely my priority.
Cool. That's awesome. What kind of car are you looking at?
Well, I drive a Jeep right now, and I like Jeeps quite a bit.
Cool.
So I wouldn't mind getting another one, but we'll see.
I like Jeeps, too. I've always wanted a Jeep, one of the ones that have the doors removed, but then we don't live in California, so it's not very practical. Savings is important because we're saying the same thing. It's also about emergencies too. So it's important to have a reserve or a reservoir of money available for all of life's surprises. Before we started this call, I was just telling Carson about how I needed to get a new car this week, and luckily I had a little bit of savings set aside because it ended up being super expensive. So the small cost of the car per month with a little accident that happened ended up being like close to $2,000 that I needed to have available. And because of savings, it was a lot easier than having to take that money right out of your paycheck. The other thing is also planning for the future. So like Carson and I were talking, what are you going to do in 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years? Do you want to go to school? Maybe plan a trip around the world. Maybe you want to go to Thailand. Maybe you want to invest in your family farm. Maybe you want to buy part of the farm and start working that as your family business. These are things that seem like they're far out, but actually end up being expensive costs down the road, which you need to start saving for now. So something we're going to talk about now is we've talked a lot about importance of saving, why you want to save. How do you start saving? Where are you going to make your money from? Carson, what was your high school job or your high school, like, young university job?
So I worked at a hotel really close to my house, a hotel and restaurant.
Cool.
I did a lot of setting up little weddings and started as a dishwasher and became a kind of a sous chef in the kitchen when I was in high school. You?
Nice. Did you work every week? Was it regular? Like, did you have a similar kind of schedule?
I did. So what I did was called formal regular employment. So nice. I was employed on the weekly basis and collected a paycheck that was fairly steady week to week.
Now, Carson, I'm going to call you out. How good in high school were you at saving?
Well, I spent a lot of money on Jeeps, to be honest.
That's true. A lot of fixer-uppers.
I was not too bad, but I had my guilty pleasures.
I think we all do, especially in high school. So easy. In high school, I did ski teaching. So I was a ski instructor. So it was formal because I was hired by the local ski hill. But it was only seasonal. So I only worked from like December till just after March break. So I wasn't working all year round, but I was working during the winter. So kind of similar. So the reason we're bringing these up is because we're actually going to get into talking about the different styles of work that are available when you are in that kind of high school to young age demographic. And again, if this doesn't exactly apply to you, the types of employment still will, so it's still relevant. So Carson, do you want to talk about this one a little bit?
Yeah, so this is kind of the example that I had talked about with my regular job. So talking about regular and irregular income, lots of different ways that you can make money, and some examples that when you're in high school are going to be hospitality, fast food, maybe it's formal employment, maybe it's not. Maybe you're going around volunteering to cut your neighbor's lawns for a price. But my example with working for the weekly paycheck at a hotel was a formal and regular job.
Right. So when you were working, Carson, was it a direct deposit or did you actually get a paycheck?
I got a direct deposit that would go in. It was actually every 2 weeks into my bank account automatically.
And did you have it attached with your parents for a while or was it always your money?
My parents actually had me set up on my own bank account fairly early, but I think they maybe rethought that for my siblings after they saw the way that I handled money.
Yeah, that's common. I know I had one account for a long time that was attached with my mom and dad, and then they could kind of like keep track of what I was spending or just see. And that's common for a lot of youth, especially as sometimes it's easier to open up an account if you already have the certain kinds of ID and stuff like that. But the next kind of employment that we're going to talk about, which also, again, all of these employments are equally as valid. It's more just about talking about how there's different ways to make money. So compared to the first guy who had a formal and regular job, this gal here on the screen, she does gardening for her neighbors, and it's not on a repeat schedule. So she does, for example, when her neighbors ask, perhaps once a month, twice a month, she goes over and helps them, and they pay her by e-transfer or by cash, whatever they have available. So her work is informal because she's not getting that regular check or direct deposit, and it's regular because it's not a set schedule. But oftentimes that kind of work is super flexible and works really well, especially when you're in school, because school can be so busy.
So the next example is a student that works at a retail clothing store, but only as a relief employee. So she only works when they need some extra people or when somebody calls in sick. That would be an example of employment that's formal, but it's irregular because she doesn't know when she'll actually get hours.
Exactly. I did work like this when I was doing my university schooling because I used it. I had one job at a restaurant, and then I had another job at a clothing store where they would call me around, like, holidays or busy weekends and stuff, and so I could just make up some extra money to save, put extra money away for school, which was super helpful. And then our last kind would be informal but regular. So informal, again, means that you're not hired by a formal company and you're not getting that regular check or direct deposit, but that the money that you're making is coming in regularly. So this example would be this girl here works with her uncle who refs the soccer team, and she helps him with the refereeing. So her uncle pays her directly. He pays her with an e-transfer, and she works with him every week. So she knows she's getting that e-transfer every week. She knows that money's coming in, and she can kind of work around that to start her savings. So from now that we know kind of like a little bit about where you're going to be making your money or how you're going to be making your money, next we're going to talk, we're going to start to kind of get into the savings.
So we're going to talk about strategies and some tips on how to start saving. So I think everybody's heard of the phrase, like Melissa said, a life hack. So we want to talk about some life hacks around money. But one of my favorite examples about a life hack is throwing a chicken burger in the toaster. Another disclaimer, make sure it's cooked. But that's my quick lunch. Another idea of a life hack is, I think everybody's suitcases can look so similar, just throwing a yellow piece of reflective tape or orange tape or something to distinguish your suitcase on the luggage slot.
Hey, Carson, this sounds a bit funny. It just kind of cut you off when you were saying, I'm not sure if the other attendees were able to hear. But maybe you could just say that, can you chat again? Because I think maybe it was just cutting out a little bit. Okay, so I think, Carson, are you still there? Virtual learning, sometimes tricky. So Carson's life hacks that he was just talking about were the were just about little tricks that you can do. I mean, we've all heard of life hacks. They're all over the internet. And probably the most popular one, which, again, in case you just didn't hear from Carson there, would be decorating your suitcase at the airport. So, like, if you're showing up with a big black suitcase that everybody else has, putting a ribbon or a fancy piece of tape on it in order to kind of better identify. This next little bit of life hack is just these funny life hacks here, which obviously don't work. The first one with the windshield wipers and the string. Someone on the internet has called that a life hack, but obviously if you're manually pulling your own windshield, that's not safe nor efficient. And then the other one is when your phone screen cracks, if you just put a plastic wrap over top, it will be good as new. Obviously, those are not successful, and please do not try at home. This is in no way an endorsement for either of those life hacks.
Thanks for the life hacks there.
Are you back?
I'm back. Sorry about that. My audio cut out. I couldn't hear anything Melissa was saying, but we're back now. So.
Okay. So it's still not, I still can't hear you great. Maybe Carson, you could try calling back in. It's giving us a little scratchiness. Hopefully you can hear me okay. Can you give me a thumbs up if you can hear me? Perfect. Okay. So our first life hack for saving is to pay yourself first. So what does this mean? Does this mean go out and spend all of your money on all of the things that you've been wanting, like new shoes, a new phone, maybe a new backpack for school? No, unfortunately, that's not the advice I'm going to suggest today. Paying yourself first actually means once you get your paycheck or your e-transfer or the money into your account, it actually means either automatically or manually taking some of that money and putting it into a savings account so that you can have it aside and you don't even think about it. Paying yourself first is such an easy way to keep your savings growing because what, for example, here, what most people do when you get paid, you spend, so you pay your bills, you send e-transfers to your friends to pay them back for the lunches they bought you. Money goes towards maybe school loans or school books. And then after all that money goes out, you think, okay, now's the time to save. And you try to put money away at the end of the month when in reality, it's really hard to do it that way. So most classic saving strategies is that, and this has been around for a long time, and this isn't, like we said, it's not an RBC specific thing, but if you're paying yourself first, once you get that money into your account, it makes it so much easier to just put that money into a savings account right away and then pay your bills and pay for your books. As well, we've also included a little icon here for charity. Many of you have probably heard that people who give oftentimes are happier, feel more stable, and kind of enjoy their lives more. And especially as a youth, giving doesn't always mean monetarily as well. Sometimes giving is with your time and volunteering, and that's important as well. So kind of keep those things in mind because that's sort of a well-rounded way to spend out a paycheck. The rule of thumb is 10%. So pay yourself first with 10% of your paycheck. So what does this look like? Let's say you have a job like Carson's where you're working with formal regular employment, and you know that every 2 weeks you get a direct deposit that's $180. When you get that paycheck, you're going to automatically put $18 or 10% of $180, and you're going to put it into a savings account, and you're not going to think about it. If you're feeling super ambitious, another strategy we like to use with this is to round up. So take your $18 and make it $20, and that little bit per paycheck is going to actually help out your savings account a lot. So on that life hack, Carson, are you back? Can you hear me again?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
It's still cutting out a little bit. It's not loving you for some reason.
All right, you take this away, and I'll try and join you for the third life hack.
Okay, excellent. So the next life hack. So first one, life hack for savings, pay yourself first. Make sure that your money is automatically going into a savings account and that you don't have to think about it. This life hack, number two, is using the right tools. So this is going to help you do that more effectively. The first tool would be to actually have a savings account. So sometimes in banking lingo, your first account will be called a checking account. And that's because people used to write checks. People don't write too many checks anymore. But the opposite of that would be your savings account. So you have your operating or your spending account where all your money's coming out of, and then you have that second account for savings where you're actually going to be able to transfer money into it to keep savings. A lot of banks have the option to automate this so that your money can go automatically. You can also nickname the accounts. So, like, for example, for me, saving for my trip to France, I could call my savings account France or travel money, and then every time I put money into it or I go to take money out, I can see that it's called something, and I remind myself not to spend out of that account. And like that little trick I was talking about earlier, oftentimes you can also add another person onto your account, and then that person can make sure that the money that you're spending is on proper things and that you're actually putting your savings away. The next hack is on budgets. So this is super helpful because what this looks like is actually planning out how you're going to spend your money. So mostly budgets are done monthly, and the reason for that is because normally bills are monthly. So, like, your cell phone bill comes monthly. Once you look at, like, renting an apartment maybe for your university or when you move out, those bills will be monthly. So most people look at the money that they bring in monthly, and then they set out how they're going to spend that money. There's lots of apps, lots of tools on the internet that you can use to do budgeting, and it makes it super simple. The one that we've created here just on this chart, for example, the top one would be your savings, so that's your 10%. The next will be for transportation, as that's a common cost for you. So if you're taking the bus or the subway, or paying your friends for gas even, The next common cost would be mobility. So how much is your phone per month? Or maybe you're lucky and you have somebody paying your phone. Next would be allocating money for fun. So how much money are you putting across to go see movies, to pay for Uber Eats, to buy new shoes, all that kind of stuff. And then the last thing is, do you have extra money in your budget to give? Or perhaps you're going to allocate your time instead and give your time. Okay, so that was our life hack number two. So we're going to pay ourselves first. We're going to use the right tools. So we're going to put our money into a separate savings account, and we're going to budget that money. Carson, if you're back, maybe you can talk about the last life hack for setting goals.
Yeah. So our life hack number three is a set goal. You might have heard of a SMART goal, but we're going with a set goal today. So that's to see it, to explain it, and then to time it. So that means, okay, I've got a goal. I've been looking on Pinterest or Instagram, and I kind of decided I want to save up for this beach vacation. And I've seen all these pictures. I'm really excited for it. And so that's what I see. That's the goal I want. And now to explain it, what's that actually going to cost? Have I researched? Let's say it's going to cost $3,000. Is there anything else that I need to factor in when it comes to cost and maybe time off from work to get there? And then timing it. So choosing a realistic timeline. Let's say I want it to be for next summer. That's when I want to go away. So I've got up until then to do it. You know, I'd probably prefer to go away around this time of year, to be honest. So let's say it's 12 months from now. I've got 12 months, and if I need to save $3,000, what do I need to save per month to get to my goal? So this, see it, explain it, time it, that's how I'm taking my big, lofty goal of saving up for this vacation and chopping it down to figure out how I'm actually going to get there.
Yeah, I super like that. It really lays it out super easy. And especially the explain it part in terms of coming up with the breakdown of your goals and how you're going to achieve them. That helps a lot and also makes things that previously could have been like a big dream or something too big to save for. It makes it realistic.
Yeah, so to kind of recap that set goal, I'm going to look around on Pinterest, Instagram, and look at these locations and visualize myself on the beach.
I like that.
And then I'm getting in a research mode. I'm going to start planning the details and figure out how much money I'm actually going to need. And then November 2021, I'm going. I've got up until then to save that money and get there. So wish me luck. I'll send you a postcard once I get there.
I really hope that I think all of us probably on this call are hoping that for November 2021, you actually will be traveling. Who knows what it's going to look like? Hard to say. I like that goal, though, and I think that putting it in those specific terms, and like we said, even on the tools hack, Carson could now go into his online banking and start his savings account separate from other savings account and have a specific account that's for vacation 2021. And because of the pandemic, we're staying home a lot. So you have, you know, all the time to research and watch YouTubes and go on hotels.com, figure out that dream vacay. Okay, so now we're going to chat a little bit about what does savings actually look like once it's in your account. And what savings actually can do for you is earn a little bit more money than just the money that you put into your account. Now, something to keep in mind is that what we're about to talk about here mostly applies if you're over 18, so you do have to be legally an adult for this to apply to you, but still good to know about and to kind of plan out for your future savings. So when you put money into a savings account, oftentimes the savings account will have interest attached to it. What is interest? Interest is the money that the bank pays you to keep that money in the account. So for example here, if you're like Carson and you have $1,000 in your November 2021 vacation account, the interest rate on that account might be 2%. So if you keep that $1,000 in the account for a whole year, you're going to earn $20 on your $1,000 just for leaving the money in that account, not touching it, and making sure it stays in there. What that means for you is that, especially for long-term savings, so if you're right now saving for school, for down the road things like buying a house, buying a car, going on a vacation once you graduate, this means that the bank will actually pay you to keep your money in that account and give you that little bit of a bonus. Interest also applies when you loan money. So this is a good thing to know just for later, that if you, for example, have a credit card or a loan, like, for example, if you take out student loans, interest also applies to those where you pay the bank money for actually allowing them to loan you the money. So either the bank's paying you interest, sometimes you're paying the bank interest, but especially when it's in the context of savings, it's super helpful and allows you that just like that little bit of extra growing room to really help you achieve all your goals.
So Melissa kind of walked you through what interest is all about, but something really cool which can work either in your favor or against, depending on if you're lending money or if you're if you've got savings, mostly on the savings side of things, you can earn interest on your interest. So that's what we call compound interest. So let's say we start the year with $1,020. So 2% of $1,020 is $20.40. So after year two, you've earned interest actually on $1,040 rather than your original $1,020. So don't just keep your money under your bed or under your mattress in your sock drawer. You might lose it. And you're also losing out on that potential interest and that compound interest, that interest on your interest. So,
Carson, do you have your November travel money in an interest-bearing account, or are you earning interest on that account, or what's going on?
Definitely. I've set up a separate account, and, I'm earning interest on my interest. It's a lot of fun. So
it makes it so easy, right? Life,
it does. It really does. And
I like it.
So to recap on these life hacks, even though I missed some of the ones from Melissa there, I'm fortunate enough that she shared those with me before. So you've got it's not what you have, it's how you manage it. So we're actually going back to Sean and Sharon's examples. So that's our first recap is stories about Sean and Sharon. Then
yeah,
Melissa,
and they just go, yeah, they're just showing you that it doesn't necessarily matter how much money you have or how much money you're making. And I think that's the important thing to take away. Whether you're listening on here and you are a student, young student, like high school or in your university or college age, it's not about being able to make $1 million a year. It's just about using the strategies that we've talked about in this video or in this presentation and kind of taking those back to your life to be able to manage your money better so that you can feel more secure. And that relates to our mantra of saving today to choose tomorrow. So goals, setting big goals, like setting dream goals, like the dream university you want to go to or the dream trips you want to take or your dream house, or in Carson's case, your dream farm. How are you putting your money away today so that when you want to go buy them later, those goals feel more affordable?
Exactly. You nailed it, Melissa. And I think it's really important for us to remember that it doesn't matter if we're making $100 or making $1,000 each time. We can still choose to start saving no matter how small and no matter what our situation is. We can make a plan and managing that money today. And going back to Sharon a little bit, if we don't have a good handle on how to manage $100, then we might make some mistakes with $1,000 too. And increasing that money doesn't always mean that it's going to go to a better place unless we're actually managing. So that's using our life hacks.
Yeah, and the life hacks here, like, your life hacks will apply in no matter situation. And like Carson just said, it may be a situation where now you're making less money than you will be in the future. And this is the best time to start putting into practice these life hacks that we're talking about, because when you have less money or when you're making less money, it's easier to start putting them into place so that you're already comfortable with them by the time you're earning lots of money and you feel really comfortable with your salary. Because you can make some mistakes when you're younger and kind of put those mistakes into practice so that when you kind of get your first, let's say, like, real job or you're making that salary and you have that money coming in, that you know you're ready to start saving. And that kind of goes back to the life hacks that we talked about. So making sure that you are paying yourself first, making sure that 10%, and if it's not 10%, maybe right now it's only 5%, or maybe right now it's just a certain dollar amount per paycheck that you know you can afford. Back to Carson's point, every little bit matters, and don't feel bad if it's not the full amount, because one day you'll get there. Using your tools. So once you're paying yourself first, making sure you have that savings account, making sure that money is getting transferred over. Using the budget to make sure that you're not spending money where you don't need to be. And finally, set goals. So see it, explain it, and time it. Look at your goals, dream big. You know, buy a house in a Tuscan villa, or buy a farm and make that your family business. But look at them and see them and plan them out and explain them to yourself and see how you can actually start saving for them.
Thanks for the recap, Melissa. That's awesome. And with that, we're kind of wrapping up here. You've all been amazing to have with us today, and Melissa and I have learned a lot from each other, and hopefully you've all learned something from us as well. Thanks for being a great audience. Really want to thank everybody for coming and for listening today. But what we really want you to take away is that saving money doesn't have to be complicated. It doesn't have to be a lot. It doesn't have to be stressful. But it's about what can you do today to have more options down the road. We don't want you to feel bad about wanting to buy things or about spending your money, especially if that's the reason you've set it aside. But we just want to remember to save first. So thank you for coming. And one other slide there from Melissa, and we'll be wrapping up.
Yeah, thanks, Carson. It's so amazing to have to just get to interact with everyone in virtually, and 2020 has been a wild year, so thanks, everybody, for joining us in this format. We do have a QR code here and a link if you wanted to copy it down for a survey to let us know what you thought about the presentation, if you found it helpful, what you thought of Carson and I. And that's the survey there. And then finally, we have our future launch website, which is kind of like what we were talking about before. But that just goes into, like we said, the skills development, the networking, even mental well-being and gaining that work experience. Kind of a comprehensive professional development resource. It's awesome, and we super recommend checking it out. So, again, thanks so much to everyone for joining us. Thanks, Carson, for being a great presenting buddy.
You're welcome. Thanks, Melissa. And thanks, everybody, for joining us.
We'll give you some time back in your day. Thanks, everybody.